Hello and welcome to the February 2014 NYCBSD Con edition of BSDTV. This is the first of six videos filmed at the con. The NYCBSD Con was held on February 8th in New York City. It was a day con with the theme of the BSDs in production. The focus was on the critical roles the BSDs can play in infrastructures. This particular talk is titled BSD Breaking Barriers by noted author Michael W. Lucas. In this talk, Michael gives an informative overview of the world of BSD along with a few war stories from the trenches. I hope you enjoy it.
So, BSD Breaking Barriers. They asked me to come here and end things up. Who am I, most importantly? I'm the guy between you and the bar. I've written a few FreeBSD books, OpenBSD, a bunch of non-BSD stuff. I've been a BSD user since the mid-80s when I got an email account at university, sysadmin since 95. In my day-to-day job, I manage Open and FreeBSD, CentOS, Ubuntu, Open Solaris, and unfortunately my boss is very, very technical. So he'll come up and say, I just discovered this cool new thing that claims to do this. Go make it happen. And usually I come back and say, it doesn't do that cool new thing they say it'll do. But, so, I've been here at NYCBSDCon many times. Last time in 2010, George told me, come and talk about whatever you want. We don't care, just show up. And this year they gave me a topic which goes to show that George can learn his lesson. But the problem is I really got this topic maybe 6 weeks ago, and usually it takes me months to come up with a talk. If this blows, it's George's fault. So, about half the group has never been to a BSD event before, so what makes BSD a little different? A lot of times in the open source world, someone will start a project and attract a community. BSD started way back in the 70s as people started writing patches and sharing them. In a way, it was a reverse. BSD is a community that came together out of people who were already doing work. And so, what have we seen so far? They asked me to wrap it up. Fine, I'm wrapping it up. Drew, ZFS is cool. Great. Ray, on why we should use BSD at internet interconnections. He also made me redo a bunch of my slides because he already covered them for me. Thank you, Ray. Andrew, I'm going to be quoting you for the foreseeable future because we use the you can always buy a bigger machine engineering philosophy. And he also thinks ZFS is cool. Scott Long, I have a lot higher impression of Netflix now. The fact that you can reproduce a bug in a weekend that would take anybody else 6 months to push enough traffic is incredibly valuable for troubleshooting. He also likes ZFS, but it's not right for him. I'd also really like to commend Jeff Rizzo. One of my favorite games is Let's You and Him Fight. And he resisted that so well. Well done, sir. And also testing. Testing is good. Please, people, we need more testing. So, and of course, George and Ike. George calls himself the Nice Bug Den Mother. I've always thought of him kind of as a cross between a Jewish mother and a Jersey Mafia boss. But the thing is, when someone like that tells you to call him the Nice Bug Den Mother, you call him the Nice Bug Den Mother. Ike, of course, playing MC. That's great. And what I'd really like to tell them, you know, George started off the day saying this was a failure. Too big, too much attention. It's much better to be a spectacular failure than a boring success. And after lunch, I have to say, your failure was spectacular. So, well done. So, why BSD? There's a lot of Unix out there. And I've been stuck trying to manage most of them. Lots of operating systems, lots of features. You can say that there is nothing new. A lot of this is recycled from other operating systems in other eras. And I feel like I should start off this talk by saying I'm fine with most of the competitors. I run Linux in the day job. I'm not going to stand up here and say such and such. Well, for me to stand up here and shout that such and such Unix sucks diseased moose wang would be highly, highly unprofessional. So I'm not going to stand up here and scream that. But this talk does contain kvetching. I'm not trying to crucify your beloved favorite flavor of whatever it is. And one of the nice things is BSD has a great community. Other Unix-like systems also have good communities. Now, one of my favorite bits of the Linux community is, of course, the classic book, Installing Linux on a Dead Badger, which is somehow a combination of humor, horror, and systems administration. If you have not read this book, you need to. It's a moral imperative. Now, of course, this is a joke. One, you cannot install Linux on a dead badger. If you want to run something on a badger, or indeed anything in the Mustelidae family, like a wolverine or what have you, NetBSD is where you go. So, one of the big differences between the BSDs and other free operating systems is the GPL. This gets into an ugly discussion in a lot of places. There are people who love to have the license war and start a bar fight over it, and we're just not going to do that here. The GPL's idea is share and share alike. And this is a great thing. We try to teach this to our children. Share your toys, share whatever. Please don't share your diseases, but share everything else. Great. BSD license is a gift. It's about making the world a better place. It raises the bar for the minimally acceptable level of code. If you can't write a TCP/IP stack better than the one in any BSD, why bother? Just take it. And as the BSD community, we want you to incorporate this code. Look at a company like Spectralogic, recently bought by EMC, I believe. They do storage. They do lots of storage. They do huge, freaking amounts of storage. I want them working on their storage. I don't want them writing a TCP/IP stack. How many of you in this room do customer support in one way or another? Help desk. Somehow the customer can get you on the phone. Do you want to be taking the phone call because your company's storage device has a lousy TCP stack or user controls or anything like that? No, no. Take BSD, use it as the minimum level. And if you doubt this, and even Microsoft, people screamed back in the 90s when Microsoft realized that the internet was a thing and they had to get on it. And it was a big deal when someone would run strings and see, oh, there's BSD code in Microsoft. Well, let's turn this around a moment. As someone who worked at an ISP as a second-level support in the mid-90s, and who's worked in corporations of all kinds of sizes, I want you to sit back and imagine if Microsoft had written their own TCP stack, imagine the cost in human suffering. How much pain would have been inflicted on every person in this room? And multiply this by the number of people in IT and the number of people just trying to make a stupid spreadsheet. If you can't do better, don't. Steal it, please. So we've seen a lot about different BSDs, but here are some of the ones I'm going to run through really quickly. FreeBSD, their goal is to do cool stuff on common hardware. OpenBSD describes themselves as a pressure cooker. They're trying to drag some things forward. NetBSD runs everywhere, even Badgers. PCBSD is a FreeBSD offshoot for the desktop. Dragonfly, I'm not really sure what their goal is, but they managed to do some cool things. And all of these come from that community back in the 70s and 80s and 90s of people who were patching and replacing AT&T Unix. So we've seen a lot about some BSD features here. I'm going to talk about some of the features that weren't really touched on. I'm going to give a little bit of detail on some features that were glossed over. Some of these slides may have flaws because some people covered topics I wasn't really expecting them to. That's okay. But if you see a typo, blame the previous speakers. So, integration. Ray touched on this, but there's a huge difference between, yes, you can run this on this operating system, and yes, this is included and expected to work out of the box. And we'll illustrate this with several hundred examples in the next little while. Another thing that comes in BSD land is this idea of tools, not policy. The BSD communities try really hard to give you tools and let you do what you need to do. They also, since they do the entire operating system, they consider that they own this. A lot of Linux distributions in particular consider themselves more of package aggregators. Other people write software, and they curate it and select it and write some stuff around it. And that works for a lot of people. But I recently took a job working with an ISP, recently being like 4 years or so, something like that. And one of the things I was doing is moving from per host authentication to LDAP. Imagine dragging out of the 1990s. So we found up for a variety of reasons. Initially, we needed to use anonymous LDAP authentication. Not great, but we couldn't do it with CentOS. CentOS's reaction was, well, yes, it doesn't work. There's a bug in the GNU TLS library that we just switched to from OpenSSL, but everybody needs to be doing non-anonymous LDAP. And could we have done it? Yes, but let's say political problems are no less problems for being not technical. BSD land, that sort of thing, is a tool. It's expected to be able to do things even if most people would consider that you're shooting yourself in the foot by doing it. So I'm going to talk about the packet filter in a little different detail than Ray did. PF is the most popular BSD packet filter. Kind of like tools, not policy, this packet filter, and indeed most of the BSD packet filters, are let you do policy instead of commands. One of the nice things is you can do expansion within a rule. Any firewall admin can look at this and see very quickly, this is what this firewall rule does. Done. But the other thing is it lets you do some more interesting things. Macros. Macros are very useful in a complicated firewall rule set. If you change your network interface arrangement, if you pick up a server and you move it and you want to change the IP address by using macros, you make one change and it percolates through the rule set. This, we also include things like lists, the second line down, pass in on the external interface from management hosts. I have a separate file that contains my list of management hosts. I update that file. It passes through the rule set. All of my hosts are easily updated that way. I'm going to compare this to IP filter. Now this is not the same policy, don't get me wrong. This is a VoIP server where we only allow connections from the United States and Canada to the VoIP services. Now, you can go online and get a list of all of the IP blocks in any given country. This is a very useful thing for specific applications. We tell our customers that if you take your VoIP phone overseas, it will not work. And by blocking out every other country, we reduce a huge number of hacking attempts. However, this list of North American IP blocks has about 53,000 entries. How many of you have tried to run an IP filter host with 53,000 IP filter rules in it? Oh, I got a hand. It wasn't very pretty, was it? So, it's not great. Fair enough. Now, IP filter has this add-on called IP sets, and it lets you do the table sort of thing that's just included in PF. Great. The problem is that, as far as I know, these individual third-party curators, the ones I work with, Ubuntu/Debian and Red Hat, CentOS, Oracle, haven't integrated this. So if you want to use that, you have to go and write your own system startup scripts. I don't want to do that. I have to do that. But I really don't want to do that. One of the nice things about IP filter is you can alter the firewall rules on the command line. As someone who's been a security administrator for a large company, one of the problems with IP filter is you can alter the firewall rules at the command line. So, sorry, what's wrong with that? You can have applications alter your firewall.
Michael, that was me and I was teasing.
Okay, fine. So with PF, you can alter the rules at the command line at specific places. You can alter tables at the command line at specific places. So you can throw in rules that say, yes, my antivirus is specifically blocking these hosts, but you're not going to overwrite my rule that says I can get in from my management hosts. Not that any of us have had management workstations that suddenly looked like they were spewing viruses because some of us like to play with weird tools or anything. So, FreeBSD in particular has multiple firewalls. One of them is IPFW. This is the original BSD firewall. The syntax to configure it looks a little ugly if you're used to something newer. Why would you have this? Well, IPFW lets you do a whole variety of network changes that you can't do under normal firewalls, because most in most cases, they're not what you want to do. For example, if for some reason you needed to simulate a T1 with packet loss to the moon, IPFW will do that for you. It will say, introduce latency and jitter. Now, a few years ago, I worked for a global automotive firm. They were deploying an application. It was web-based. It did engineering and design, and it was going to save them millions of dollars, except for the fact that it was really slow from Europe and Asia reaching these servers in the United States. So the developer would make a change. He'd send an email to people overseas. When they got in the next day, they would run the test and send the results back and say, no, it's not fixed. The developer would make another change, send another email, and this dragged on. I got involved more than once. I'm doing packet sniffing. And finally, one day, I got sick of it. I said, I'm not doing this meeting again. I grabbed like a Pentium 150 and threw FreeBSD on it, said, okay, this took IPFW and said, you're now in Bulgaria, behind a 768K line, adjusted the latency, did some tweaking to make sure I was getting the same results that the Bulgarians were reporting, and took the developer, sat him there, said, this is a magic cable. This cable is in Bulgaria. And he was thrilled. And mainly because this meant he did not need to get on a plane and fly to Bulgaria until the problem was fixed. And this was all well and good until they said, can you give us a magic cable that's in Malaysia? So I had this little farm of Pentium 150s, but each with, you know, a little country label on them. But this is something you can't really do elsewhere without installing third-party tools and hacking on them. And the FreeBSD people own this. They say, yes, this is ours. If you have trouble, we own it. There is no third-party package that you can go futz with. Another FreeBSD thing is NetGraph. If you're a kernel programmer, this lets you develop network protocols quickly, plug them together. I've heard it called networking tinker toys. And doing things quickly is important. Sometimes you'll want to stick with this prototype. Sometimes you'll want to re-implement. But the thing about IT projects is when we get a new project, we say, oh yeah, I want this project to do a really hard thing. I'm gonna put up a web interface for it, I'm gonna have a database for it, and I'm gonna do this really hard thing. And we start off by writing the web interface and the database and put off the hard thing. NetGraph kind of lets you fail quickly. You know, you can try this difficult thing in the network protocol and just see if it's gonna work at all. Don't waste your time with the easy stuff. Make the hard stuff as easy as possible and immediately succeed or go on to your next brilliant idea. I'm going to jump into OpenBSD for a moment. The OpenBSD operating environment hates software. If you look at any piece of code, more than once I've had a programmer come to me. Now I'm a system administrator. I'll bring someone a error message or a core dump, and they'll come back to me and say, I have no idea why this ever worked. Never mind the crash you're having. How does this work at all? And code is complex. We've all heard of buffer overflows, of memory corruption, etc. And sometimes code works because you didn't realize that you were using that buffer overflow, or you didn't realize you were using this characteristic of memory mapping, or how ports are allocated, or something. The OpenBSD folks do their very best to kick the legs out from every one of those assumptions. The general idea being, if your code runs there, you didn't do anything really boneheaded. That your code works because it actually works. That's kind of nice. Okay. Poudrier. The FreeBSD ports and packages system for many years was considered awesome. It's revolutionary for 1995. My understanding is it was originally intended as a temporary thing, and we'll do something better when we get the time. Well, it's 20 years later, and we're finally getting the something better. The new packaging system will look very familiar to people who are used to apt or yum. Now, for many years, the Linux folks looked at our ports and packages system and said, that's great, we have to do something like that, and then they went and did something better. Well, this will let the FreeBSD folks jump ahead of apt and yum again, which is fine. That's the way that the software community works. We goad each other on. Ha-ha, we're better than you now. Which is part of the fun sometimes. The nice thing about Poudrier is it's very simple. I have set up Debian package building systems before. And it took me quite a while. And I lost a little bit of hair. It became much simpler to shave my head than deal with where you pull out your scalp, because that just hurts. So setting up Poudrier, half an hour, done. And it builds packages for all of my systems exactly as I want. It's letting us build packages for weird combinations. It will let the FreeBSD folks upgrade their ports tree. Dragonfly has actually adopted, I'm not sure if it's, is it the primary package system or it's a, oh, it is. Okay, it's primary for the new Dragonfly, or 3.6. And some exciting things are going to happen there, I'm sure. The hard part, of course, is pronouncing the name. Poudrier is French for powder keg, because when you're trying to build packages, that's when your hardware blows up. So, FreeBSD again, Capsicum is a capabilities and restriction system for Unix-like operating systems. That's supposedly, now I'm not a programmer, so supposedly this is actually usable by real programmers doing real work in the real world. They've come out with a version of Chrome that is actually locked in with Capsicum. It's been useful enough that I believe Google is paying to have it ported over to Linux. But it will take them a while to get to where FreeBSD is now, and by then FreeBSD will be further ahead. If you're looking for a way to lock down your software, I would tell you to look here. So, OpenBSD has this project they're doing now for a long, long time, T. They're ready to kill the year 2038 problem. And when I first heard of this, I thought, well, okay, they're getting a little ahead of themselves. But the problem is code lives a long time. There was the example of a nuclear plant that is fortunately downwind of me in Ontario that their software ran on a PDP 11. This soft, yes, BSD all the way. They finally replaced this system using a modern AMD 64 machine running a PDP 11 emulator. And the same software. It runs faster. Great, that means it's gonna get to year 2038 ahead of the rest of us. Thanks! So, this installed base of code lives for a long time, and the sooner we can get rid of this issue, the better. I mean, personally, I would not be shocked by the year 2038 either. A, someone will shoot me by then. I can't rule that out. B, I may need one or more medical prosthesis, such as, say, a pacemaker, or a whole artificial heart, or the way I'm going, artificial stomach and liver, but I don't want any of those organs to get a call on December 31st, 2037, and say, we need you to get to the hospital right now to have your flash upgraded. No, please fix this now. The nice thing is that the OpenBSD community has a small but involved user base. This means that they can, if you have an individual who files a bug report with a third-party project and that says, I moved my system to a long, long time T and your software crashes, the software author is going to say, you're an idiot. Go away. If a bunch of people file bug reports that say, your software crashes on OpenBSD, you'll get a different reaction because that's a whole operating system. So this small entity can really move larger bodies. And I've had more than one person ask me how this can happen. So at this point, I'm going to ask for a volunteer from the audience. Preferably someone a little large, and preferably with health insurance. You, sir, you had your hand up first. Come up here. Yes, you, red shirt. And you told me your name, and I completely spaced on it. Please. Excellent. If we run that PDP under an emulation, we can find the bug in a weekend. Excellent. So, he's not a small guy. Actually, this works. So, do me a favor and grab my wrist. So.
Do I have to kiss it next?
Oh, no. The if I'm this small user community and he's the big body of the internet, and if you want to really tense up, you can, but this may get ugly. We can do all kinds of things and just kind of lead the body of the internet around and put them wherever we want and say, okay, you're coming up to this higher plane. Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. So. Yes, a small community can have a large impact on a larger body. Although I'm really glad he didn't tense up, because I'd feel pretty bad about breaking his shoulder. Well, kind of bad. So, Hammer, another interesting BSD feature, this time from Dragonfly. People have said a lot of things about ZFS. Yes, it's cool. We haven't talked much about UFS because the fact that it has been continuously engineered for decades and actually has all the many bugs worked out of it really isn't interesting. Hammer is a little different. The file system actually keeps a fine-grained history at 30 to 60-second intervals. There's a file system level undo command where you can go, oh crap, I really screwed the pooch. Okay, the whole file system's back. It also does snapshots, so you can say, I'm about to upgrade, we're gonna make this snapshot and keep it. They have pseudo file systems, which is somewhat like a ZFS file system. It's a sub-file system where you can set properties. For example, it's kind of stupid to keep a history in var temp, so don't bother doing that. And built into the file system is streaming the file system to remote machines. Now, yes, there are ways to do this with Linux. There are ways to do this with FreeBSD and HAST. Which I probably should have mentioned HAST in this talk. Okay. But this is built right into the file system. And if you want to talk to someone about Hammer or Dragonfly, we have the release engineer, Justin. Yeah, wave your hand. So, that's really kind of cool. So, OpenSSH. The original SSH software was released under a very liberal license. Some of the OpenBSD guys noticed that. They went back to the last liberally licensed version and brought it up to date. They now own 98% of the SSH server market. Actually, this is a problem. Anytime you have a software monoculture, one, nobody's really pushing you to improve. And two, if anyone does figure out a problem, there are an awful lot of vulnerable machines. So, I would really love to see someone else take on OpenSSH and write their own and put it under a BSD license so it can be taken in and used and things kept secure. And So, GEOM. GEOM is a FreeBSD thing. It is not an acronym. It's short for geometry, as in disk geometry. It's a layered and stackable file system tool. This is how FreeBSD implements their various RAID schemes. This is how you can share storage across the network with HAST. I guess I did include that. There are two different kinds of encryption here for two different use cases, which I personally found kind of interesting. Jelly is the sort of thing you would use on your laptop if you don't want your confidential documents stolen. GBDE is different it's what they would call embassy-grade encryption. It protects the user. Put yourself in this situation. You're in an embassy in some small country that nobody else has ever cared about. That's just cold, but. So, we'll say a small country that nobody cares about other than Canada. And gunmen break into the embassy. Protocols are triggered. The disk encryption is wiped. The critical blocks that store the keys are blown off the disk. And they come in, they grab someone, put a gun to their head. and say, type in the passphrase, decrypt the disk. Now, as a human being, I'm going to type in that passphrase. I don't care. We spend a lot of time talking about how hard it is to decrypt such and such algorithm with so many bits. And really, the best cryptography in the world is a hammer and your kneecaps. It works every time. If you type in the valid password on a GBDE encrypted device, it says, you have entered a correct password. The decryption blocks no longer exist on the disk. This data cannot be decrypted. And if you type in an invalid password, it says invalid password. So it does what it can to protect the user. Is this important? Well, if I'm in a job where this is important, I have the wrong job. But you may make other life choices. And if you do, I want you to have a system that at least the gunman may get mad and shoot the computer instead of you. And I would consider this preferable. So let's look at some other FreeBSD things. The recent release, pluggable TCP/IP congestion algorithms. I imagine Netflix is probably interested in that. NetMap, direct to hardware packet I/O, 10 gigabit saturation with tiny packets, now up to 65,536 routing tables. And yes, ZFS is cool. Fine. I said it. And to people on the outside, BSD in general may seem like a squabbling camp. Well, it's Dragonfly or death. But we're kind of like, you know, hockey fans. We'll argue over who the best team is. But at least we're not like those football fans. We're all in this more or less together. We'll sit down and have happy, civil conversations. So I'm going to close by making my trip tax deductible. You can buy some of my books online. There's a coupon code for that, my website and whatnot. And I am going to take questions, but I have one thing I want to do first. George has done a lot of work on accounting and stuff, and I would like to really mess that up. I brought a bunch of books to sell. This is the last one. I could have sold it a dozen times over, but I'd like to auction it off to support the convention and let them split it up. So this may be humiliating as you all look at me and say, no, we're not buying that. So this is the new BSD book I did, newest. Who'll give me anything for it? Anything. How much?
I don't know. $40.
$40, okay. Do I hear 45? I will sign it. I'll even sign it with my own name. Well, $50, okay. Someone can do better than 50.
Come on, with a personal note from Michael.
Saying that this is a special copy auctioned off. Come on.
I'll sign it too. My name's in there.
Okay, George will sign it too.
60, he isn't allowed to sign it.
Okay. 60 if George can't sign it. Do I hear 65? I take credit cards. 65. 70? Come on, 70 is list price, guys. 70.
500.
Excuse me?
500.
Yeah. Sir, could I have your name?
Boris.
BK at FreeBSD.org. $500 for an OpenBSD book. My suspicion is, for that kind of money, you can get everybody in the room except George to sign it. Do I hear 505? Going once. Going twice. I was hoping for like 80. Another spectacular failure, yes. So, are there any questions? Yeah. Yes, sir. $500 gets you a whole lot of answers. Okay, I'm going to repeat that for the advantage of folks at home, because and also because anything Boris says right now, I'll happily repeat. Anything. I wouldn't make that offer to GNN, by the way. That IPFW can use multiple processors where PF has run under the big giant lock for many years. And IPFW can also take user land packets, 20 million packets a second on commodity hardware, feeding into user, to or from user land. And if I screwed that up, I'm sorry, I'm just a writer, I'll ask you to come up and say it yourself in the mic. Anyone else? Actually, could you come up and use the mic so I don't have to repeat you? First one to the mic wins. Go. It's on?
They can hear it on the internet.
Okay. The internet can hear it, the people in the room can't. You're good.
All right, so you touched on IP tables.
You still have to talk into it, though.
You touched on IP tables. Any thoughts on NF tables, the new successor to IP tables?
NF tables, my gut reaction is, thank God it's about time they did something resembling sanity. I understand that's very harsh, however. I have spent days debugging IP tables problems, and my dislike for IP tables is hard-earned. So what is it like? I'm waiting to really have a strong opinion on NF tables until I see it more in the real world. But I'm glad we've encouraged them to improve. I don't know that I would make that statement. Yes?
First off, your bit about TCP/IP stacks gave me some traumatic flashbacks to 20 years ago fielding calls from senior citizens running trumpet windsock. Thanks for that.
You're welcome.
Still hold that opinion in a post-Snowden world, and
That's a very subtle way to ask that question. Okay. Full disk encryption for most people, most of the time, is a waste. Now, the short answer is because these days, anyone who really wants in your laptop can say, do something to the SATA driver in the firmware of the hardware to get access to your data. For most people, full disk encryption, when I hear someone say, I'm doing full disk encryption, what I hear is, I get this vision of the future where they go, help, I've lost access to my data. And that still applies. For most people, you're more likely to lose data than be investigated. Now, if you have sincere concerns about the NSA accessing your data, then by all means, encrypt it. There are people who have very valid reasons for not letting whoever look at their laptop. I mean, if you go back to the Zimmerman hearings in Congress over PGP, where he talked about medical volunteers who were, insurgents were attacking them with machetes. And they couldn't protect themselves, but through using encryption, they protected their coworkers. If you're in that kind of situation, if you are doing things where you have a sincere concern about outside powers looking down upon you for what you do, then by all means encrypt your data. Know the risk you're taking, and just for the record, if you're using it to hide your kiddie porn, I will come after you with a machete. Just so we're clear. Now, does that answer the generic question?
What about the second part?
Yeah. Second part?
When's the updated
book? Okay. I just finished my previous writing project. So, the next thing this year, I am expecting to put out one small OpenBSD book, and at least two small FreeBSD books. The general size of the SSH and sudo books that I did, with the eventual goal of doing several FreeBSD books that will be consolidated and remixed, if you will, into a larger book. So people will get some FreeBSD and OpenBSD material more quickly. You can buy it in exactly the quantity or subject you want. And is this some extortionate scheme to make everybody buy all of these books and then absolute FreeBSD third edition? Well, no, but the covers of the small FreeBSD books will be commonly themed and designed to go together in a slipcase, if I can figure out how to get that done. So, so yes, it's about extracting more money from you.
I'd like to actually respond back to the point about encryption and full disk encryption.
There's a mic there. You have to hold it.
I've never been told I needed a mic. So I want to actually go back to that, because actually I think that's what has changed drastically. If you had said on June 3rd last year that full disk encryption wasn't an issue, there was generally consensus around the world that, you know what, you're right. The risk of losing your data is a bigger deal than actually having it taken. I think there's been a drastic shift. And I think actually if you go back, and there's a reason why WikiLeaks used that operating system that originated in a basement, OpenBSD, there's a reason why these questions are much harder today than they were before. It's because the stakes are actually quite high today. It's not just about looking at, you know, firmware and so on and so forth, because now we sit there and look at our own NICs and we see lights blinking and we're going, is that a NIC or is that a management port for another three-letter government agency at this point? I mean, that's the world we're living in today. So the opening of the debate that's going on for the past 6 months is wildly significant, I think, particularly for the BSDs. You know, random number generation is no longer an abstract question that cryptographers should just sit there and look at. Everybody needs to start reassessing. And I don't just, obviously I'm not pointing it at our community specifically, but I think in general it becomes a massively important issue. I think if you look at the question of monocultures out there with anonymity networks such as Tor, that is potentially one of the most disastrous, dangerous things that could happen right now. You want to talk about SSH, open SSH monoculture? Okay, yes, it's an argument. Yes, it needs to go on. Yes, open SSH is everywhere. But even more disturbing to me is actually with Tor, that monoculture, that, because that's not only the Linux RNG that's the heart of it, but also Debian and that OS that's sitting on top of the Linux kernel. So I think, again, what might have been true, say, June 3rd, you know, before Snowden's disclosures, and then June 4th and the world shifts, I think these are massively important questions, because you go through an airport today in whole parts of the world, there is a very good chance your data will be taken and copied and so on and so forth. And it's not just about dissidents and lawyers and human rights activists anymore. It's actually a much broader thing. And I actually think we're the people and we're the community that actually needs to make a big stink in it of what's been going wrong, why a lot of the previous models of software development, licensing, lawyers need to be consumers of these products. Lawyers do not need to be the ones front and central dealing with the licensing.
So. Two things on that. One, George is right. That's a great topic for discussion in very shortly here as we go into bar time. And two, right there is my argument that George really needs to try decaf. Any other questions? Excellent. I'm done.